Welcome back to She Takes on the World TV. I'm your host, Natalie McNeil, and joining me today is conversational influence trainer, Shari Alexander. This episode is all about supporting you to become more influential so that you can make a bigger impact in the world. Let's dive in. When you go into a meeting or a negotiation, what are some of the first things that you notice about the people in the room?
Well, that's a great question, because usually when people are approaching those types of meetings or negotiations, they're concerned about what should I say? You know, what is it the thing that I need to say to be awesome? And that's the worst place to start, because influence isn't about what you say, it's about finding the right thing to say for that person.
Okay, so say that again.
Yes. So influence isn't about what you have to say, it's about finding the right thing to say for that person. So Observing them, paying attention to them, works in so many different ways, because it takes you out of your own head. You know, it releases all the burden off of your shoulders. So it's just like, okay, let me just pay attention to you for a little bit to figure out what is interesting to you. So to specifically answer your question, what is the first thing that I notice? It depends. It depends on what that person is showing me. If they're very businesslike, if they're playful, if, for example, let's say if we were to first meet and I shake hands with you, and if I were to like, okay, so right away, so you're very, it's a very dominant thing to do, to take my hand like that. But the way in which you did it, you leaned forward a little bit, it was very intimate, friendly, like comforting. So I would pay attention to that. I'm like, okay, I think she's confident. I think that she can handle herself. So let me, and I never jump to conclusions. I'm just looking for that little bit of evidence of what can I learn about this person.
Okay. So taking that one step further, because you mentioned if somebody is really businesslike or if somebody's really playful, how would your approach change based on what you notice, based on these nuances? So how would you approach the really serious businessman versus the more playful, creative entrepreneur?
So then I just try to become an authentic chameleon. I want to change myself in a way that I'm not acting, I'm not pretending, I'm not being something that I'm not, but I am shaping myself to match that person as best I can. So if they're very serious, I'll probably start off as very serious. And then I'll notice for those significant changes in the conversation, if I can perhaps get them to be more playful, if that's where I want to guide them to. And that would show me that we have more rapport, because clearly they feel more safe with me. And if somebody's more playful and bubbly and loud, then I'll get a little bit more, you know, playful, bubbly, and loud with them. But if I mismatch, and if somebody is very serious, very facts and figures, and I come in with like, let's just talk about pretty things, it's probably not going to connect as well. So I get a sense of like where they are energetically, what's interesting to them, and then I match and I mirror that as much as I can to still being me. You know, it's all about authenticity and influence.
What happens when you have these different personalities in the same meeting? So if you have the serious person and the creative, playful person, and they're all at the table.
Yeah.
They're all at the boardroom meeting.
Sure.
What does that look like?
Yeah. So if it's a group, first of all, I ask my question of who is my mark? And so mark is just simply my shorthand way of saying the person you want to influence. And if there's a group of people, maybe they're all my marks, but there's generally just only one or two people that if they are on your side, then the rest of the group follows.
Okay, interesting.
So I also pay attention to who might be the necessary yes, and then who might influence that person. It, you know, like who is their right hand man or woman? And then I just make sure that I guide my influential intention towards them, those specific people. Also in general, so as a fellow professional speaker, I'm sure you know that there's all different types of personality types and all different types of learning types in every audience. So the great thing is that if you're doing an actual presentation, in my mind, influence is so much easier, because then you just go through the checklist of things of, okay, do I have visual metaphors, auditory, kinesthetic? Do I have stories? Do I have facts and figures? Do I have a quote from an authority figure, like just all you have to do is hit the check marks, and then whatever they gravitate towards, that's what they'll remember. Mm. See, I started out as a speech and presentation coach, and one of the reasons why I started to get more into conversational influence is because you're basically influencing without a net. You know, with a presentation, you get to prepare, you get visual aids, you get to learn about the audience, they don't get to talk back.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things helping you, supporting you in that arena. And that's cool, but I just like the more death-defying acts of influence where in a conversation they can interrupt you, somebody else can come in, and you have to be quick on your feet. And that's why I found those people that I've interviewed and learned from, like the CIA agents, like the con artists. That's why I find them so fascinating. And that's why I think everybody else needs to be able to do what they do too.
Okay, so with CIA agents mm-hmm. and con artists that you've had the opportunity to sit down with and speak to and interview, what are some of the big takeaways from that that has helped you in the work that you do?
Yeah. I think the biggest lesson for me was how ego-less so many of them were. So especially when it came to the CIA agents, because in my mind, like, they're superheroes, you know, they literally go into the bad places and fight the bad people and save the day, and we never hear anything about it. So I thought that they would just be like, you know, chest puffed up and like, yeah, I'm awesome, you know, look at me, yeah, kind of a thing. But they weren't. They were some of the sweetest, curious, kind people. Even the con artists. I mean, that's one of the reasons why people fall for con artists, is because they're so sweet and kind and they care and they listen and they pay attention. So with a few exceptions, I mean, like, of course there's a few con artists that weren't like that. And then of course there were the pickup artists who really weren't like that, but there's always exceptions. And for me, it was that complete paradigm shift of people have this idea that influence is about power. It's almost coercive, like, I'm going to influence you and I'm gonna, you know, push you in a certain direction. And in their world, really, it's about, let me learn about you. I'm curious about you. Let me, you know, listen about your story and let me pay attention to you and probably see you in ways that nobody else really has. And I think that that's just such a beautiful thing of the best influencers. It's not about them, it's about everybody else. I think that's actually kind of almost a spiritual lesson interwoven into this world of influential communication.
I love that.
I'm pretty excited about the challenge that I'm going to take on and our viewers are going to take on this week. Yep. That you are about to teach us, because as entrepreneurs, as we were talking about earlier, it's not what do I need to say, it's what do I need to know. And we can all benefit as leaders and entrepreneurs by just being more observant.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Every single day. So I want you to introduce us to your five vibes, the mm-hmm. influential vibes framework, and give me my challenge for the
All
week.
All right, here we go. So the five influential vibes are the things that we can notice, pay attention to, and see in everybody, in every situation. They are everywhere. It's just a matter of, we haven't been tuning into them. It's kind of like our antenna haven't really been up and paying attention. So the things that we want to listen for, and specifically, again, this goes towards our whole thing about conversational influence, is these are the things we're going to like elicit out from somebody during just normal everyday conversations. And so the five vibes are values, identifiers, beliefs, emotional triggers, and then secret goals and desires. So I'll quickly run through all of those.
Okay.
The values are basically our human operating system. It's what we decide is good, what we decide is bad, what we should do, what we shouldn't do. And we learn our values, obviously, from our upbringing, our religion, our society, our gender even, the things that society or people have told us, this is good, that's bad. And so when we listen to somebody, we want to pay attention to what's important to them. Is spontaneity important to them? Is creativity important to them? Is being grounded, is family important to them? Is travel, like, what is it that they value in their life? So we're just going to listen for, what do you care about? That's the values.
Okay.
Next is the identifiers, which is one of my favorites, because when I tell people about identifiers, they're like, I don't know if that's really out there. And I'm like, just listen. And then they're like, oh my gosh, it's everywhere. So identifiers are literally when the other person tells you who they are. And I often think back to this famous Maya Angelou quote where she says, when somebody tells you who they are, believe them. Yes. So listen to who they say that they are, because as influencers, we are not pushing our world into theirs. We're about learning their world. So it's, how do they see themselves? What labels are they putting on themselves? I'm a mother, I'm a morning person, I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a go-getter, I'm a hustler, I'm lazy, I like to sleep all day. How are they labeling themselves? Because then when we want to influence them, we'll see how we can make that connection between the label and our influential intention and make a nice marriage of it. So that's the identifiers. Next up is beliefs. Beliefs is basically the stories that we say about the world around us of, you know, if this happens, then this is how I interpret that. So what do they believe about, and specifically for entrepreneurs, this is even more important. What do they believe about the current problem? How do they see it? What do they believe about themselves? And how do they believe they interact with that problem? Do they believe, oh no, I got a handle on it? Or do they believe I'm a hopeless case? So what are those beliefs? And then what do they believe about you? And then what do they believe about the solution that you're offering? So what are those already ingrained beliefs that they have? And just pay attention to that about people in general. We all have stories that we say about our lives, right? And then we have our emotional triggers, which is the E in the vibes. And that basically is what puts that person in a positive mood and what puts that person in a negative mood. So especially like in sales, we want to know what puts them in a negative mood about the problem. Like, is the paperwork really bugging you, or is it when your manager comes in and asks for follow-up? Like, which of those really just sets you off, right? Because then if we can solve the solution of the paperwork or the manager, now what we're discussing is much more interesting and intriguing to that person. And then also what puts them in a great mood? Is it family and kids? Is it time, you know, spent alone and reading? What is it that we can perhaps weave in to say like, hey, I can bring you more of those positive triggers into your life? And then lastly is our secret goals and desires. I say secret because it sounds sexier, but it absolutely can be stated. When somebody tells you, who is this higher self that they want to be? What are they striving for? What do they want in their life? Who is this person that they envision themselves as? And then if you can speak to that higher self, if you can speak to those goals, then instantly you're elevating them. You're bringing them closer to something that they want. But you wouldn't be able to do that if you haven't been tuning in for those secret goals and desires. So that's the rundown of the vibes.
Awesome. Okay, so we're going to take the vibes.
Yes.
And we are going to turn them into a daily practice.
Yes.
What does that look like?
Okay. So anytime that we're interacting with somebody, there's different ways that you can approach this. One is just every day you can write out V-I-B-E-S, values, identifiers, beliefs, emotional triggers, secret goals, and desires. And anytime you have a conversation with somebody, right after that conversation, go write down the vibes that you observed. It can't be the next day. Our memory, and I know you're talking to Jim Quick at some point, I love Jim, but our memory will always fail us. He's the memory guy.
Jim's gonna want to debate that.
I know. But we need to write things down because we will forget. And so if you wait 24 hours or you wait even just a few hours after that conversation, you're going to forget. It's best to do it while it's still hot off the presses. And so just write them down and then practice keeping that awareness of, okay, what are the vibes? You also could just do one vibe a day if you like during the challenge. Is maybe Monday, I'm just going to focus on values and I'm going to listen for values. And Tuesday, just going to listen for identifiers. And that will still work that part of your mind muscle, so to speak. Then my favorite way of practicing the vibes.
You look so excited right now.
Because
so,
this is my favorite pastime.
This is making me really excited.
Is when we're binging on Netflix.
Okay.
We can practice this.
How many of you have done that?
It's how
I've never done that.
I just want to live binging on Netflix. So we can actually improve our observational awareness during our most like downtime, free time moments. And that's whenever we're watching a program that we love, whether it's scripted or unscripted, it doesn't matter. It could be the news. As you're watching, just have a notebook paper and have V-I-B-E-S written out. And then as you're watching, and you need the paper in front of you, you can't just tell yourself like, oh, I'll think about that because you'll forget. You need the paper in front of you to like, oh yeah, I need to be remembering this. And as you're watching, think of like, well, what are the vibes of Frank Underwood in House of Cards? What are the vibes of Jon Snow in Game of Thrones? What are the vibes of one of the women of Housewives of whatever place? And that way, as you're just entertaining yourself, as you're having some downtime, you're still doing some training in your mind of being more observational and paying attention. Because we want this to just be happening in the background. We want to train that muscle so it's just always there. And you're not having to like constantly like, okay, I have to think about the vibes right now. We're just going to train it.
Okay, Jon Snow, give me his vibes. Let's do this.
On the spot. All right. Okay, so Jon Snow, obviously loyalty is very important to him. Family is very important to him. His word is very important to him. I try not to do this without any spoilers.
So this is tricky.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert. Go for the spoilers.
Okay.
We did the disclaimer.
So for example, when he has an opportunity, I'm a total nerd, so I can talk about this. So when he has an opportunity to actually no longer be a bastard and take on the Stark name from King Stannis. Yes, I'm totally talking about specifics.
This is making me so happy right now.
Totally into this right now. So he turns it down. Even though that's something he's wanted his entire life, he's given his vow, he's given his word to the Night's Watch. So clearly his word is very important to him. So his identifiers, clearly he was a bastard growing up. That identified him. But he always strived to be a part of the Night's Watch before he knew what it was about. So that was this higher self. He believed this beautiful story of what the Night's Watch really was. Even when that world, like when he realized what it was all a bunch of thieves and awful people there, he still was going to strive to be the best he could be in that space. Beliefs, I think a belief around his world is possibly like, be honorable, be the best you can be, and things will work out, or things will be the way that they're supposed to be. Then when he, spoilers, when they kill him, and he gets resurrected, then obviously now he's in a whole new space that we're going to see of that belief has completely shattered. So what happens when a belief gets shattered? We'll find out. Emotional triggers, obviously, the loss of his lover, Ygritte. That's going to be a painful trigger for a very long time. And then secret goals and desires. I think secretly, especially at this point, now that he's leaving the Night's Watch, I think he secretly wants the house to come back. I think he wants the Stark's name to be valuable, and I think, who knows, maybe he wants some power. Maybe he wants some revenge. I'm not entirely sure yet.
Wants the Iron Throne.
He just might.
I have goosebumps now. Isn't that ridiculous?
I love it.
I love Jon Snow.
Yes.
Okay, so this is amazing homework for the week.
It's a big one, but I believe you and everybody watching can definitely do it.
And then once we have the vibes, we're recording these in our notebooks. Mm-hmm. What do we do with that information? How do we take it one step further?
Sure. So obviously with the TV shows and stuff, there's not much you could do. You could kind of play a fun game in your mind of like, how would I influence this person? What would I say? Okay, cool. That's a great mental exercise. In the real world, you want to keep those vibes. I use Evernote for my vibes profiles because you might meet somebody, learn something about them, and then it may be months till you see them again. And we won't remember all those things that we wrote down. So having a file to go back of like, oh yeah, you know, beach days are like her favorite thing to do, and just remember those things. So you have those notes. Then we build that connection. So now I know what's important. Now I know how she sees herself. Now I know what she believes about things. So my next step in the three steps of influence, observation, that's the vibes. Next is connection. So that's building rapport. So I'm going to bring up the things that she values. I'm going to bring up things that she enjoys to make sure I have rapport. You cannot influence somebody. You have not earned the right to influence somebody without making a connection first. That's when we get into coercion and manipulation. So then, once we have that connection, then it's like, okay, well then, how can I take these vibes, and then how can I take what I want from this person, my influential intention, and where can I find those connection points? How can I make a nice marriage of these things? So if she wants beach days, and she's overloaded in work, and I can help her be more efficient, rather than saying, oh, you'll have some downtime, or oh, you'll have some free time, or you'll be able to get more accomplished, I would say, and then you'll probably be able to have two more beach days a month. So much more specific, so much more grounded, so much more tailored to her. That's how we start to get out of the world of speaking jargon to our clients of efficiency and time management. It's like, no, you get to have more time with your kids, and you get to have more date nights with your husband, whatever that is that's important to them. That's how we truly influence somebody, by finding that marriage between their vibes and our influential intention.
I love this challenge. I've loved this whole conversation, actually. And I really hope Daenerys Targaryen has been watching for when she meets Jon Snow.
I know, even though
this could come in handy.
Yes, yes. I want them to get married, even though they're cousins, but that's okay. At least they're not twin brother and sister. It's fine.
King, queen, rule the kingdom.
Yes, with their, yes, all their beauty.
Exactly. This has been so great. Thank you so much.
Thank you. This was fun.